In this video, we will solve a few problems chosen from the previous year's question papers of different competitive examinations like ESC, GATE, etc. Based on the topics that I discussed during lecture 1 to lecture 5 of my series on complex analysis. If you have not watched those videos, I would recommend you to watch those videos before you start solving problems. So let's start with a few problems in this video. The first one, as you can see, the general value of log 1 plus I plus log 1 minus I is, we have four options. Now this log is the natural logarithm with base e. So let us solve it. Let us try to find out the general value. Now we know that log 1 plus I plus log 1 minus I can be written as equal to log 1 plus I into 1 minus I. As we know, log A into B equal to log A plus log B if the base is same. So this can be written as equal to log 1 plus I into 1 minus I. That means 1 minus I square. That means log 2. Now, since we need to find out the general value of this, I am writing this 2 as 2 into 1. Now, that means this can further be written as log 2 into, now we know that the value of e to the power twice n pi I is equal to 1. So this can be written as log of 2 into e to the power twice n pi I. Now again, if we apply the same formula, we can write this as log 2 plus log e to the power twice n pi I. Now remember, these are natural logarithm. That means the base is e in both the case. So this can be written as simple log 2 plus, and this can be written as 2n pi I. So the value becomes log 2 plus 2n pi I. Now let us check the options. Yes, option C. So the answer will be option C. So we can write that the answer is C. The next problem. If z is a complex variable with I equals to root over of square root of minus 1, the length of the minor axis of an ellipse defined by this z minus 1 plus I plus z minus 9 plus I mod of z minus 9 plus I equal to 10 is, we have to write the answer. Fine. I have already drawn an ellipse here. So we know that by definition, an ellipse is the set of all points in a plane such that the sum of the distances from two fixed points, which we call as foci, of any other point is constant. And that constant is the length of the major axis. So what I mean to say is, if we consider, say, this as one foci and this as another foci, say this is z1 and this is z2. This is the center of the ellipse, let us name it by P. So this is our major axis. So this is the major axis. And this is our minor axis. Minor axis. We need to find out the length of this minor axis. Now let us further assume that this length is A. That means the length of the major axis is twice A. And let us assume that this length is B. That means we need to find out what is the value of twice B. Now, as per the definition, what I was meaning is that I said that the definition of an ellipse is the set of all points in a plane such that the sum of the distances of any other point from two fixed points, which you call foci, is constant, and that constant is the length of the major axis. That means in this case 2a. So if I consider any point z, then the distance of that z from z1 will be mod of z minus z1. And the distance of the point z from z2 will be mod of z minus z2. As per the definition, the sum of these two will be a constant, and that constant will be the length of the major axis, that is 2a. So this is how we get the equation of an ellipse, and the problem is given in that form. So here, if we identify, therefore here, what is our z1? Z1 can be considered as 1 plus I. What is our z2? Z2 can be considered as 9 plus I. And what is my a? 2a is equal to 10 here. That means a is equal to 5. So these information are given to us. And moreover, this z1 in coordinate form can be written as 1, 1. This z2 in coordinate form can be written as 9, 1. So if we write that this z1 is 1, 1, we can mention here that this z1 is 1, 1. This z2 for this problem is 9, 1. So these are the things which are given to us. Now, the center of the ellipse is the midpoint of the line segment joining the two foci. So if we consider that, that means this P can be found out as half 9,1 plus 1,1. This is the coordinate of the midpoint of the line segment joining the two foci, that is z1 and z2. So if we calculate, this will be 10,2, so 5,1. So 5,1. That means furthermore, we have got that this point P is actually 5,1. So the center of the ellipse is at the point 5,1. So we got that also. Now, let us consider that this particular length, that is the length, the distance of the center and a foci is C, any foci. They will be equidistant. So let us consider that as C. So we further know that it is a known property of ellipse that a square minus b square, a square minus b square is equal to c square. This is a known property of ellipse. Now, we need to find out 2b, that means we need to find out b. For that, what we require? We require the value of a and c. If a and c is known, then we will plug in this formula and we will get what is the value. So now for that, what we know what is the value of a and what is p. Now the question is, we know what is p, we know what is z2, and what is c? The length of the line segment joining p and z2. Can we find that? Of course we can find that. Therefore we can write c will be the length of the line segment joining p and z2. That means p will be square root of 5 minus 9 whole square plus 1 minus 1 whole square. So that means this will be square root of 4 square. That means this is simply 4. So what we got? We got a as 5 and we got c is equal to 4. And furthermore, we have this relationship a square minus b square equals to c square. This is a very important relationship and well-known relationship for ellipse. From this relationship, we get b square is equal to a square minus c square, which implies b square equal to a square means 25 minus c square means 16. So that is equal to 9. So b square equal to 25 minus 16, that is 9, which implies b is equal to 3, which implies b is equal to 3. Therefore, we have got the value for b. Now, what we need in the question? As per the question, we need the length of the minor axis. Therefore, we need actually 2b. Therefore, 2b is equal to 6. So, we got the answer. Therefore, what is the length of the minor axis? The length of the minor axis is, I can write now, 6 units. The length of the minor axis is 6 units. So, we got the answer very nicely. So, let's switch to the next problem. Given a complex number z, interpret geometrically z into e to the power I alpha, where alpha is a real. I've already drawn a circle here because we know every complex number can be plotted on a circle. If you have forgotten, just watch or revise my lecture on polar form of a complex number. So here, let z equals to r e to the power I theta. Let z is equal to r e to the power I theta. That means I'm saying if I consider this as a circle of radius r, so if this angle is theta, if this length is r, that means this is my z. This is my z. Z equals to r e to the power I theta. So this is my z. Fine. So we need to find out z e to the power I alpha. So z e to the power I alpha is equals to r e to the power I theta into e to the power I alpha. That is equal to r e to the power I into theta plus alpha. That means this z e to the power I alpha will also lie on a circle of radius r, the form says, because we know z equal to r e to the power I theta lies on a circle of radius r with the angle or the argument theta, the principal argument theta. So z equals to r e to the power I theta plus alpha will also lie on a circle of radius r as per the form. But now the argument will be theta plus alpha. That means we need to shift this r counterclockwise to alpha, means from theta it will move to theta plus alpha. So we need to give a alpha rotation more to this. That means if we rotate in this way, if maybe something like this, if this angle, if this is my alpha, if this is my alpha, then maybe somewhere this will be z e to the power I alpha. So this is my z e to the power I alpha. So this is where z e to the power I alpha will lie. So geometrically we can say that this geometry tells us, or the interpretation may be that e to the power I alpha works as an operator which when operates on z, z gets a counterclockwise rotation of an angle alpha. So that is the geometric interpretation. It gets a rotation. When you operate, it's an operator. It rotates z to alpha, counterclockwise rotation of an angle alpha. So this is how we can interpret. The next problem. If n is a positive integer, then root 3 plus I whole to the power n plus root 3 minus I whole to the power n is, we have four options. So we need to evaluate this. Pretty simple, since it is root 3 and the coefficient of I is 1, immediately it triggers in my mind that root 3 by 2 and half. Because root 3 by 2 and half, you know why I am saying that. Because sine and cosine, for sine and cosine, this root 3 by 2 and half can be obtained for the same angle, that is pi by 6. So if we apply that, I can write this term as 2 to the power n into root 3 by 2 plus I into half plus 2 to the power n to root 3 divided by 2 plus I into minus half. I've intentionally adjusted in this way so that we can, sorry, I've missed this whole to the power n. Now this implies 2 to the power n, as we all know, this will be cosine, root 3 pi by 2 means cosine pi by 6 plus I sine pi by 6 whole to the power n plus 2 to the power n into cos, okay, I'm leaving this first, let us settle that one, I into sine minus half. So sine pi by 6 is half. We know sine minus theta means minus sine theta. So I can write it minus pi by 6. And cosine minus pi by 6 is cosine pi by 6. So that will remain root 3 by 2. So our problem is solved. Whole to the power n. That means equal to 2 to the power n. Now if I apply the Euler's formula, I get e to the power. This gives us e to the power I pi by 6 whole to the power n. That means e to the power I n pi by 6 plus, okay, let us take this 2 to the power in common. Now, by Euler's formula, this gives us e to the power minus I pi by 6 whole to the power n. So plus e to the power minus I into n pi by 6. Now, we know by Euler's formula, from Euler's formula, we know that cos x, we can write cos nx is a simple consequence of Euler's formula as e to the power inx plus e to the power minus inx divided by 2. So if we apply this formula here and adjust this by 2 things, so I'll multiply this 2 to the power n with a 2, and in inside the second bracket I'll divide by 2, I will get what? I will get this equal to 2 to the power n plus 1 into cos n pi divided by 6. So I am getting 2 to the power n plus 1 into cos n pi divided by 6. So that is my answer. Now let's check the options. 2 to the power n plus 1 cos n pi by 6 is option D. So my answer is option D. So fine, this is my answer, option D. Next problem. Given two complex numbers, z1 equals to 5 plus 5 root 3 into I, and z2 equals to 2 divided by square root of 3 plus 2i. The argument of z1 by z2 in degree is this, okay, in degree, fine. Now remember, if you look at the options, you will get to know that by this argument, we are meaning actually the principal argument. Although it is not written, but we are meaning as the principal argument. Okay, fine, let's find argument of z1. We know that if z equals to x plus iy, then the principal argument of z can be written as tan inverse y by x, or arc tan y by x, if z equals to x plus iy. So by that logic, argument of z1 will be tan inverse. For this particular problem, this is my x and this is my y, and here this is my x, this 2 is my y. So fine. So for z1, tan inverse y by x, so 5 square root of 3 divided by 5. Oh nice, this gets cancelled. I am getting tan inverse square root of 3. So that is equal to, in degree we need to give the answer, so this is 60 degree. Now argument of z2. So argument of z2 similarly will be tan inverse, in this case y is 2 divided by x is 2 divided by square root of 3. So again, oh, it is the same, tan inverse square root of 3. So that is 60 degree. Now we need to find out argument of Z1 divided by Z2. Now we know that argument of Z1 divided by Z2 is equal to argument of Z1 minus argument of Z2. Both are same, so the answer will be 0. Now let us scan the options. 0. So that is A. Therefore, for this problem, the answer is A. So this is how we can solve this problem. Okay, fine. That's it for this video. In the next video, we will solve a few more problems.